Hi, I'm Ellen from the Chili Dog, and this is week one of the Line Drawing Socks Knit Along, hosted by my friends at Maker's Mercantile. This week we are going to be casting on our sock and knitting the leg. As you can see, I have my materials ready. I have my pattern, my Zitron Art Deco yarn, and my bamboo addi FlexiFlip needles. Throughout the knit along, I'm going to be demonstrating on the FlexiFlips. However, this pattern is written in needle neutral terms, which means if you are already a sock knitter and you prefer using DPNs, or you prefer a long circular needle to do magic loop or knit your socks two at a time, that's perfectly fine. Before we start knitting, make sure you head over to Ravelry and join the Maker's Mercantile group. There you're going to be able to find a discussion thread that's dedicated to the Line Drawing Socks Knit Along. During the month of May 2019, as the knit along is occurring, this is your place to ask questions, get answers, share your progress, and see what other knitters are doing. Before we start knitting, I'd like to give you a quick pattern reading tip. We're going to talk about the difference between parentheses and brackets in a pattern. And even though they look very similar, in knitting they mean two very different things. When you see numbers inside a parentheses, it's going to correlate to the size of the item you're making. When you see brackets in a knitting pattern, it refers to a series of stitches that will be repeated again and again and again. So first, let's look at parentheses. As you can see, this pattern has five different sizing options. And each size is shown inside, either on the outside here of the parentheses or inside the parentheses. So each one of these sizes is going to require a different number of stitches. In your pattern, whenever you see the parentheses, you want to just look at the number of stitches or the number of repeats that correlates to the size you're making. I am going to be making a size small throughout the knit along. One helpful tip, you can use a highlighter and highlight the number that correlates to the size that you are making throughout the pattern. And I have already done that for week one. I've highlighted just the number inside the parentheses that correlates to the size of the sock that I am knitting. Brackets refer to a series of stitches that you're going to repeat again and again. So you can see here in round one, we start knitting, and then we're just going to repeat this purl one, knit three, purl one, knit three, purl one, knit three, again and again around the sock until we get to the last two stitches of the round where we'll do something else. Now that we understand a little bit about brackets and parentheses, let's cast on our socks. We're going to be working our line drawing socks from the top or the cuff of the sock down to the toe. Whenever you are working socks from the top down, it's very important to use a stretchy or elastic method to cast on your stitches. You want this cast on edge to be tight enough that it holds around your leg so that your socks aren't droopy, but you don't want it so tight that this edge is digging into your leg all day. Also, you need to make sure that this edge is going to stretch out far enough that you can stick your foot into the sock. When I am knitting socks from the top down, my three favorite cast-ons are the old Norwegian cast-on, the cable cast-on, or the long tail cast-on. You can choose to cast on how you like, but I am going to be demonstrating how to do the long tail cast-on. When you're doing the long tail cast on, there's a couple ways that you can get things started. You can either use a half hitch or a slip knot. A half hitch is a little bit more advanced and fancier and means you don't have a knot at the beginning of your yarn. To make a half hitch, you have your working yarn. You're going to cross your yarn tail over the top of your working yarn and it makes a little loop here. I'm going to pinch that loop and just hold it in place. And then you can insert your knitting needle from right to left through the loop, and then just pull the working yarn and the yarn tail, and it tightens that loop up. And it's perfectly fine to start your long tail cast on like that. Another way to get your long tail cast on started is by making a slip knot. And this is probably a method that most knitters are more familiar with. And for me on camera, it's a little bit easier to hold things in place so they don't wiggle around on me. So you make your slip knot, insert your needle, and pull on your working yarn to tighten things up. So back here is my working yarn, up here is my yarn tail, and you'll notice that my yarn tail is kind of long, hence the name long tail cast on. You'd usually want your yarn tail to be about 4 to 5 times longer than the length that you're casting on. Also, normally when you're doing a cast on, this first loop that's on your needle, whether it's a slip knot or a half hitch, usually this counts as your first cast on stitch. However, today, since we're knitting in the round, I'm going to actually use this loop to close up the jog that will happen between our last cast on stitch and our first. So I am not going to count this as a cast on stitch. To get started, we have our working yarn here at the back, the yarn tail here at the front, and take your index finger and your thumb on your left hand and just go right between those two strands of yarn. Now, with your other three fingers on your left hand, you're going to wrap them around the working yarn and also around the yarn tail, and you're going to just hold it in place. As you're casting on your stitches, you really don't need to let go of these three fingers and let go of your yarn unless for some reason you need to retension your yarn as you're knitting. Rotate your thumb back, and this is called the slingshot position. You have your working yarn here over your index finger. The yarn tail starts out at your knitting needle, goes back around your thumb, and then is held here in your hand at the front. To begin casting on stitches, your knitting needle comes forward under the yarn tail, up through the thumb loop, back and over the working yarn, grab the working yarn and pull it forward through that thumb loop. Once it's through, you can drop the thumb loop off the thumb and then use your thumb between the working yarn and the tail and pull it forward to tighten up that tail. Rotate your thumb back into the slingshot position and you have your first stitch. So let me show you again. The needle comes forward, under the tail, up through the thumb loop, back and over the working yarn, grab the working yarn and pull it through the thumb loop, drop the thumb loop, and pull that yarn tail forward to tighten things up. And as you're tightening things up, you don't need to strangle your knitting needles. You just want a consistent tension that holds the stitch on the needle, but not too tight. So knitting needle forward, under the tail, up through the thumb loop, back over the working yarn, pull the working yarn through the thumb loop, drop the loop off your thumb, and pull the yarn tail with your thumb. Rotate your thumb back. The knitting needle comes forward, under the tail, up through the thumb loop, back over the working yarn, pull the working yarn through the thumb loop, drop the thumb loop, and use your thumb to tighten up the tail. So this one doesn't count and I have 4 stitches cast on. I'm going to keep casting on my stitches and I want half of my sock stitches on this first needle. Technically, I could cast on all the stitches and then divide them between my two needles, but it just makes more work for me to do later and I'd rather just take care of it right away. So I'm going to cast on half my sock stitches and then I'll show you how to start the second needle. I've cast on 30 stitches, or half of my sock stitches, onto my first needle, and now I need to cast on 30 stitches onto my next needle. So I'm going to rotate this 90 degrees so it is pointing up. Grab my second knitting needle, and I'm going to hold them perpendicular to each other, and I want to pinch them together right where that last cast on stitch is. And I'm just going to hold them close together, and this helps prevent there from being any gap in the side, in the knitting in the side of our sock. So again, I'm going to get my yarn position the same. I'm going to put my index and thumb through between the working yarn here at the back and the tail at the front. Grab the working yarn and the tail with my other three fingers, and then rotate my thumb back, and you can see we're in the slingshot position again. So while I'm pinching the needles together at a 90 degree angle, I'm going to continue casting on my stitches. So the new needle comes forward under the tail, up through the thumb loop, back over the working yarn, pull the working yarn through the thumb loop, drop the loop off my thumb, and then tighten things up. And just make sure that that first stitch is pretty tight, because again, you don't want a gap here on the side of your sock. And for the first couple stitches that you're casting onto the second needle, you'll need to hold these needle tips together. After you get a couple stitches cast on, they're naturally going to be held together by the yarn. So rotate the thumb back, and I'm going to cast on the rest of my stitches. I cast on my second 30 stitches onto my second needle, and now I just want to make sure that my stitches are not twisted, and you can see here that I have a nice edge of the stitches all on the inside of my needles. So I would either be ready to start knitting in the round, or in this case we're going to close the gap first before we start knitting in the round. To close up that gap, first I'm going to just bring my yarn tail forward here just so it kind of stays out of the way. And I want to shift the first 30 stitches plus that one extra down to the other end of the knitting needle. So I'm just going to slide this knitting needle all the way through so that the stitches are on the other end. And once the stitches are at the other end, I don't know why, the edge of the stitches always remind me of alligator teeth. So you have this nice smooth edge here of alligator teeth in the center. You just want to make sure that the stitches aren't twisted around your needles, say like this. The alligator teeth should not go around the needle. So let me untwist them. And then we're going to close up the gap that sometimes can happen when you are knitting in the round. So first, I'm going to turn my needles and point them in the other direction. And again, this is my yarn tail here, and I'm keeping it at the front. This is my working yarn, and I'm keeping it underneath the needles. I need to close that gap again, make sure that the alligator teeth aren't twisted around the needles. And then I'm going to slip the very last stitch I cast on from this needle, and I'm going to slip it over to the first needle. And it's not too hard to do. You want to make sure you're not twisting it, but it's not too hard to do because it opens up because it was that last stitch we cast on. So I'm just going to slip it over onto the first needle. And then you don't need that huge stitch there. It makes it hard to work. So you can just tighten things up a little bit by pulling on the working yarn. Now we want to pass the first stitch that we cast on up and over the top of the last stitch and then off the needle. So you can just use that third knitting needle to do this. So I've got the very first stitch we cast on. I'm going to slide things down a little bit closer to the tip, just being sure I don't pull it everything off my needle. And then I'm going to pass that very first stitch up over the top of the last stitch. And just don't drop it off the needle, the last stitch. So the first stitch is off. I'm going to pull it out. And you can see now we're not going to be knitting into it. It got pretty much bound off here to close up the little jog. And that's why we didn't count it at the very beginning of our knitting. Now we can move our last cast on stitch back from this needle back onto the one it was on before. And again, it opens up pretty easily, making it easy to move. Just make sure you don't twist it as you're passing it back. And then you can pull on the working yarn to tighten things up. And now you'll notice that we've got that flat edge of alligator teeth there in the center between our needles. And now that the little jog or gap is closed up, we're ready to start knitting in the round. If you're already a sock knitter and you're used to either using DPNs or magic loop to knit socks, I will admit the addi FlexiFlips feel kind of weird for the first few rounds as you're getting used to them. But ultimately, they kind of combine the best of both magic loop and DPNs. Before we start knitting in the round, let's get oriented. This is my working yarn. This is my yarn tail. This is the last stitch that I cast on. So I'm going to start knitting across this needle. And these stitches here are the stitches that are on the top of the sock foot or the front of the leg. Once I get to the end of this needle, I'll knit across these stitches, which are half of my sock stitches. And these stitches are the stitches that are at the back of my leg or the bottom of my foot. And we'll be working with a third knitting needle in our right hand. So, since these stitches are the ones I'm going to be working, this needle right here is going to be our non-working needle. We're just holding the stitches there for now. So I'm going to slide the stitches that are on our non-working needle down to the center of the cord. And you want some of the stitches to be on each needle, but ultimately they're held here mostly on the cord. And then we're going to be working across this needle with our third needle. I like to balance this back non-working needle in the crooks of my fingers in between my index finger and my thumb on both hands. This is not the only way that you can hold the needles. Since they have some bend, you might find a position that's a little bit easier for you. For me, I just like to balance that non-working needle in the crooks. And then we can begin knitting across our stitches in our pattern. And I'm going to demonstrate here. First, I'll do a round or two in English style, and then I'll show you in continental style. Really, I hold the needles, this non-working needle, the same for both styles, but it's nice to see it both ways depending on how you knit. Also, before we start knitting in the round, you may want to clip a little locking stitch marker around this first stitch to remind you that it's the beginning of the round. I prefer to actually just use this yarn tail as a guide, and I know that when I'm ready to start working across a needle, if the yarn tail is here on the right, that I am at the beginning of the round. So I'm going to take my third needle and insert it through, and I'm going to start knitting across. And again, this non-working needle is kind of balanced in between the crooks of my fingers, and then I'm going to work across with the third needle. And now I'm beginning that repeat where you purl one, knit three across the stitches again and again and again. So purl one, knit three. And you'll notice here, my working yarn is staying behind this non-working needle. As I'm working across at the beginning of the round, or at the beginning of going across this first needle, the non-working needle is balanced primarily on my left hand. As I get a little farther along, it kind of moves and it will be balanced more onto my right hand. And usually about the time that you get about halfway across a row, that's when you'll find that it's more balanced here on your right hand. And now as I'm coming to the end of this first needle, you will see that all the stitches have come off the left needle and now they're on the needle that I was working on in my right hand. So this is going to be my new non-working needle. So I'm going to pull the stitches down to the center of that needle so that they're held on the cord primarily, but they're also a little bit on each side up on the knitting needles. I'm going to set that third needle down just so it's out of the way here so you can see what's happening. I'm going to rotate my work, and now I can start knitting across. Let me get the yarn tail out of the way. I'm going to start knitting across this next needle, but before I do, I need to slide the stitches down to the tip of the needle. And sliding them feels a little bit tricky here in this first round, and really that has more to do with it being the first round of your knitting than that you're using the flexi flips, because the first round always just feels a little bit tighter and harder to move things around. So now that the stitches are at the tip of my needle, again, this non-working needle in the back, I'm going to hold it between the crooks of my fingers, and then I'm going to work with this needle and one in my right hand. First stitch here happens to be a purl, so that's just a little bit awkward, but not too bad. Once I get that first one tightened up, move my yarn to the back, and again we're just continuing that purl one, knit three around. And depending on what size of sock you're making, you may not have the purl one at the beginning of the round. You may have knits instead, because you're just continuing with the pattern, the purl one, knit three. You're not necessarily starting it again when you get to the beginning of another needle. And again, you can see once I get over that halfway mark, that non-working needle that's in the back kind of is balanced more on my right hand than my left. Once I reach the end of the needle, again, there's no more stitches on this needle. So that's what's going to be my new right hand needle. I'm going to slide the stitches I just finished down to the center of the cord and a little bit on each side. I'm going to rotate my work, get this yarn tail out of the way, so the stitches that I just finished are held on this back non-working needle, and these are the stitches right here that I'm going to knit across now. I'm going to slide them down to the needle tip, and you can see even after I get that first round finished, they slide a whole lot easier. And I keep my working needles at the front and my non-working needle at the back. I'm going to grab my third needle and continue knitting. And I'll go across this needle English style again. And then I'll switch to continental when I do the needle change at the end of this one. So I made it to the end of the needle. The one that is loose is now going to be the one that's in my right hand. So I'm just going to shift it over. The stitches I just finished, that's going to be my new non-working needle. So I'm going to shift everything down to the center of the needle so it's on that flexible cord. Rotate your needles. Pull that tail forward. And again, here's the non-working needle is going to be at the back, and I'm going to balance that in the crooks of my fingers between my thumb and my index on each hand. I'm going to slide my working needle here, slide the stitches down to the tip. Oh, and I said this time that I would do continental style, which is not my favorite, but give it a whirl here. So you'll see that non-working needle is still balanced in the crook of my fingers, even though I'm going to knit continental. My first stitch is a purl. I'm just going to tighten it up a little bit because things seem to get a little loose for me when the first stitch is a purl. And yes, I can knit continental style, but I'm a whole lot slower at it. And again, you can see once you get past that halfway point on the needle, the non-working needle balances more on your right hand than your left. And again, once you get to the end of the needle, this is going to be your new right needle. The stitches you just finished knitting get slid to the center. Rotate your work. The stitches that you're going to be knitting come down towards the tip. The non-working needle kind of gets balanced in the crooks of your thumb and index finger. And then you just keep knitting around. So I'm going to work a little bit on my ribbing, and then I'll be back to talk to you a little bit more about knitting sock legs. Earlier, I had a chance to talk with you about the importance of using a stretchy or elastic cast-on method when you are working socks from the top down. Now that we've got all our stitches cast on, and hopefully you're getting nicely established in this ribbing pattern down the leg of the sock, I'd like to take a couple minutes to address some other issues that you can sometimes have when you're knitting socks from the top down, and also give you a little bit of insight into my design process as I was creating the line drawing socks. The first thing we're going to talk about is that jog that we fixed earlier when we were casting on our socks. As with so many things in knitting, the method that I taught you is not the only method you can use to minimize this little jog and close up the gap. There are a lot of different ways to do it. Some knitters don't like to do anything special at all. Sometimes they'll just cast on the actual number of stitches that a pattern calls for, omitting that extra one that we use to close up that jog. And sometimes they'll just use the yarn tail, and as they're weaving in, just pull that jog shut. I particularly like the method that I taught you because at the end of your sock knitting, when you're ready to weave in your yarn tails, what you're going to be able to do is you're going to be able to take this yarn tail, pull it through to the wrong side of your work, and weave it in here on the wrong side of the sock. And when you do that, you're going to be able to kind of slant this last stitch, or I guess it's really just the yarn tail as you're pulling it through, that you slant it a little bit, and you end up getting this nice uninterrupted slanted yarn all the way around the leg of the sock. And to me, that just creates a really pretty effect up at the cuff. The next thing I'd like to talk about a little bit is something that can happen with the addi FlexiFlips, and something that's also fairly common when you're working socks on double pointed needles. It's can be a little bit tricky, especially as you're learning to knit on double points or on the flexi flips, to keep your tension even as you're switching from working on one needle and going across to working on the next. And sometimes it can be very visible, your change in tension right here, and it's called laddering. But there is a way that you can kind of avoid it or minimize it when you're knitting with the flexi flips or with DPNs. And let me show you how I do it. And again, people have a variety of different techniques and methods to do this. This is just what works for me. So as I'm ready to switch from knitting on this needle to the next one, I slide my stitches down. I'm going to tension my yarn, grab my right needle, and as I am working that first stitch on the needle, what I want to do is very similar to what we did as we were casting on and switched from the first needle to casting on the stitches onto the second needle. I like to make sure that the needle that's in my right hand, this one, is held up to the needle I finished knitting on and the needle that I'm about to start knitting on. Right now, my needle in my right hand is touching both of the other two needles, and I want to keep it touching for the first few stitches as I'm working across. It looks like I split my yarn there. I want to keep all three of those needles touching as I work the first few stitches, and that's going to minimize any weird tension problems that could happen and minimize the laddering I'll get as I'm working across. So I'm just going to keep those needles touching, kind of pinched together for the first few stitches as I'm going across that next needle. And once you get a few stitches done, as with when we were casting on, the needle now is naturally going to want to stay close to this one. The yarn is holding it so that you're not going to get any strange gapping right there, which is really nice. And again, this technique works well with the flexi flips, and it would also work well if you were knitting with your socks with DPNs. It doesn't work quite the same when you're working on magic loop, because these stitches here on my non-working needle, if you're working magic loop, all these stitches are held on the cord of your knitting needles, and so tensioning things can be a little bit different, and that's not something I'm really going to address, because I figure that people who are doing magic loop probably already know how to do magic loop. It's not something I'm going to teach in this knit along. Now let's talk a little bit more just about some general sock knitting and sock design. You might be wondering why most sock patterns have some sort of ribbing at the top of the cuff or even down the entire leg of the sock. And there's a reason to have ribbing. And I'm going to lay my sock out flat here. When you work ribbing, ribbed fabric is naturally a little bit narrower than if you had worked in something like stockinette stitch. The fabric would be a little bit wider. So this is going to be a little bit narrower, and you want that around your leg because you want the sock to be hugged around your leg so it doesn't fall down. If your socks fall down all day, it's just uncomfortable and not very nice to wear. Also, you may be wondering why I chose 3x1 ribbing, because there are lots of different ribbings that you can use for socks. But for this pattern, I specifically chose 3x1 ribbing, which just means there's 3 knits and 1 purl, all the way around, as opposed to, say, a 2x2 or a 1x1. One reason that I chose the 3x1 ribbing is it's snug enough that it's going to hold these socks up around your leg, but it's not so tight that it's going to constrict your leg. I personally don't like using 1x1 ribbing, which just means you knit purl, knit purl, knit purl all the way around to create your ribbing. I don't enjoy that for socks because to me, the fabric, again, anytime you use ribbing, it's a little bit more narrow than if you were knitting and stocking it. And to me, 1x1 ribbing is simply too tight. So I wanted something that was firm enough that it was going to hold up around your leg, but not so tight it was going to constrict your leg. Also, 3x1 ribbing, I think, is very easy to remember the stitch pattern and to read your work. And I wanted something that was easy to remember and easy to work, because as you're working the leg of this sock, you'll notice the color work that is emerging from the Zitron Art Deco yarn is absolutely wonderful and fun to watch. I wanted you to be able to enjoy watching that color work come out without having to concentrate super hard on your stitch pattern. Also, I figured that many people would want to do this knit along to kind of learn and get a feel for the addi FlexiFlip needles. Again, I wanted a pattern here that was going to be easy to remember and easy to stitch so that you could concentrate more on how to use the needles than having to worry about what stitches to make. And the final reason I chose 3x1 is because it's primarily knits. There's 3 knits for every 1 purl. So again, it's going to show off this striping pattern that's naturally happening in the yarn. Another question you might have as you're knitting your sock is why I chose to make the sock leg so long. It's 7 inches, and then we're going to change the pattern here, the stitch pattern, just a little bit before we start the foot. But so there's going to be a total of 8 inches of leg. Those of you who know me in real life or are familiar with some of my other knitting patterns know I tend to prefer socks that have a shorter leg, either ankle length or maybe just a little bit taller. And part of that reason is because I live in Arizona, and even though I wear socks year-round, it's hot. And so I generally like wearing socks that have a shorter cuff. However, again, because of the color work, I wanted there to be plenty of room here for you to see all the beautiful colors and the designs that were going to happen as you're knitting this leg of the sock. So if you have any other questions about sock knitting or about this specific pattern or about my design process as we're knitting along together, there's a couple things you can do. First of all, during the knit along in May 2019, you can head over to Ravelry and leave your questions in the Makers Mercantile group in the discussion thread that is dedicated to the Line Drawing Socks knit along. I'm going to be checking that thread daily and trying to answer your questions to the best of my ability to help you out so you can be successful in knitting your socks. If you happen to be knitting these socks after the knit along is over and you still have questions about how to knit or something about my design process, feel free to leave your questions in the comments below this YouTube video. I will try to get back to you as quick as I can if you leave a comment in the video. Generally, I don't check my YouTube comments every single day, and I don't always respond to everyone, but if you have a question, I always do try to respond. It just might take me a little bit of time. And one final question I want to address before we finish up the leg of our sock is some of you may be wondering, once you get through this ribbing, why suddenly the pattern, stitch pattern, is going to change in the last 1 inch of the leg. And again, there's a couple of reasons that this is going to happen. First of all, if we look here down at the bottom part of the leg, right where we're going to start our foot here soon, the stitch pattern naturally is going to start widening out. And if you think about your leg and your foot anatomically, generally, as you work down your leg, your body widens out as you get to the top of the foot and around the ankle at the top of the foot. Also, I wanted to continue here in a stitch pattern that was visually similar to this ribbing. And you're going to notice this last inch or so is very close to that. There's just a slight difference there. But I wanted something that was going to be flatter as you worked up across the top of the foot. And part of that is, as you're knitting a sock, you don't want the top of the foot to be clingy and grabby. You don't need the foot part to be held up. The leg needs to be held up so it doesn't slouch down. But generally, having a flatter fabric across the top of your foot is just a little bit more comfortable. And you'll notice that here on the back of our sock, we've started knitting in stockinette, which is just plain knits all the way around at the back of the leg and what's going to turn into the bottom of the foot. And again, there's a couple reasons I chose to do this. One, next week when we start knitting the foot of our sock, it's going to be easier for us to set things up for our afterthought heel with stockinette instead of having to worry about a fancy stitch pattern that could be a little bit confusing. Also, you'll find that a lot of socks use stockinette stitch at the bottom of the foot because generally people don't necessarily like a lot of texture on the bottom of their foot. It may feel uncomfortable for them. I hope you enjoyed week one of the Line Drawing Socks Knit Along. Next week, we are going to be setting up for the heel of our sock and we'll also be knitting the foot. If you'd like to share pictures of your progress of your sock so far, you can go ahead and post a picture in the Makers Mercantile group on Ravelry in the Line Drawing Socks Knit Along discussion. Or if you'd like to share something on social media, make sure to add hashtag Line Drawing Socks KAL to your description. And you can also tag me at the Chili Dog and tag at Makers Mercantile so we can stop by, say hi, and see how you're doing. Until we stitch again, happy knitting!